I want to welcome you to the Charles DeLisi Distinguished Lecture, the second one of its named after Charles DeLisi, and that honors a senior faculty member in the College of Engineering who has had an extraordinarily distinguished career and impact in his or her field of research. Let me first start out by announcing the Early Career Excellent Award, an award we give to a junior faculty member who has shown extraordinary promise early in their career and as an assistant professor. And is J.C. Bird here? J.C., congratulations. J.C. blows bubbles and then explodes them and then sees what happens. Okay, so let's begin. The College of Engineering Charles DeLisi Distinguished Lecture Series celebrates high-impact research in engineering, and as I said, will annually honor one of the distinguished faculty that have made a huge impact in the field, or one of our distinguished alumni that have made a huge impact in their field and hence society. Charles DeLisi himself is a heroic figure and an iconic figure in the history of the College of Engineering. He became dean in 1990, I believe, and was dean for 10 years and literally transformed the College of Engineering into a primarily undergraduate institution onto its path and then eventual success as a major research, high-impact College of Engineering, and a world-renowned one that attracted extraordinary talent. And without Charles, we would not have many of the extraordinary faculty that we now have on our faculty, nor many of the PhDs and alumni out there that are making an impact on the field. And we are deeply indebted to not only, of course, his impact to the College of Engineering and transforming us to this research, high-powered institution, but his impact on the field alone in genomics and his role in basically creating and initiating the funding necessary for the Human Genome Project. And mostly, I'm indebted to him as dean for many reasons. First, as a former mentor, of course, personally. But he's now created the first named endowed lecture series in the history of the College of Engineering. So please join me in thanking very much Charles DeLisi for all of his impact on the college. And Charles, stand up. Not much light here, so I may have to put my glasses on. Today's speaker is Professor Selim Ünlü. He is a distinguished professor of engineering, a professor in the Department of Electrical and Computer Engineering, the Department of Physics, the Department of Biomedical Engineering, the Division of Material Science and Engineering, and the Division of Graduate Medical Sciences. He is also a member of the Nanotechnology Center, whose name has been changed recently, so I forgot it, but it used to be called CNN. He is a member of the Photonics Center and the Center for Computational Science. He's an associate faculty member of that. This list alone conveys the extraordinary interdisciplinary nature of Selim's work and how he's leveraged that into the high impact he's had on the field. He received his Bachelor's of Science degree from the Middle East Technical University, Ankara, Turkey, and his PhD from the University of Illinois in Urbana-Champaign, all in electrical engineering. Since 1992, Selim has been a faculty member of the college. He has served as the Associate Dean for Research and Graduate Programs in Engineering, where he transformed the quality and research direction of our graduate programs and started us on the path to where our rankings moved from 52nd to 35th this last year. He has also served as the Associate Director for the Center for Nanoscience and Nanobiotechnology. Selim's research interest area is in the area of nanophotonics and biophotonics, focusing on high-resolution solid immersion lens microscopy of integrated circuits and the development of biological detection and imaging techniques, particularly in multiplex detection of single viral pathogens and protein and nucleic acid microarrays. At Boston University, Selim is a recipient of a 2002 ECE Faculty Teaching Award and the 2006 College of Engineering Faculty Service Award. His students have received more than 40 awards, ranging from the best senior design projects in ECE and BME to numerous graduate science day awards, and from the College of Engineering's Societal Engineering High Impact Best Dissertation to the first prize in the nationwide CIMMYT Primary Healthcare Award. He is a recipient himself of several, in fact, many awards, and here's just literally a few. And I mean a few in quotes, because I don't have time to tell you all of his awards. He is editor-in-chief of the IEEE Journal of Quantum Electronics, general chair for IEEE Photonics Society Annual Meeting, the Tubetak, I may have said that wrong, it's the Turkish Scientific Foundation Special Award. It's their highest award given in Turkey for scientific achievement. He's an IEEE fellow, elevated for contributions to optoelectronic devices. He has won the Australian Research Council Nanotechnology Network Distinguished Lecturer Award, the IEEE Laser and Electro-Optics Society Distinguished Lecturer, the Boston University ECE Faculty Teaching Award that I mentioned, the United Nations Tocton Unistar Award. He's won an NSF Career Award early in his career and the Office of Naval Research Young Investigator Award earlier in his career. And again, I could have gone on. He has published over 170 papers in peer-reviewed journals and another 180 conference papers and has 5 patents, and his work has been cited over 7,000 times. He is truly distinguished, and it's my honor to introduce to you Professor Selim Ünlü.
I see my microphone is now on. We have a whole bunch of engineers, and we have duct tape. If anything goes wrong, we can fix it. I'm going to put this down for now. thank you very much, Ken, for that very kind introduction. And I'm truly honored and humbled to receive this award. I'm glad that I didn't receive it several years back, because now it's called Charles DeLisi Award. He's my hero, he's my mentor, he's my friend. I'm so happy that I'm receiving an award and delivering a lecture to a distinguished audience like yourself, named after him. So I'm going to start with some disclaimers. I'm going to be giving the lecture instead of the guy in the picture. I try to resemble him as much as I can by wearing the same outfit almost. But I should probably stand like this and smile. I remember one of the first compliments I received from Ken was introducing an award. I don't know which one it was. It was the first year of being an associate dean working with him. And he looked up the screen and says, "Wow, that's what you look like?" And I can tell you that the photographer, BU photographer who took the picture, we were chatting while he was taking it, 10,000 pictures to make one look good. He said, "There is no old people. There is only insufficient diffuse light." With lighting, we can do it, wonders. Today, I'm going to talk about, as the title says, soap bubbles, simple stuff. And hopefully we'll be able to apply that to detect individual pathogens. Okay, what's my motivation? Before Matt Groening started to draw Simpsons, he was doing Life in Hell. Those of you who are old enough will remember those cartoons. That was around the first year in grad school for me that he published something called Grad School is Hell. And I always felt like I'm this little bunny rabbit. Ask the question, will your research make the world a better place? And he's not so sure. He says, "Yeah, sure." He's mumbling a little bit. And next to that, I put my own Simpsons character. There was an option online. You could make your own Simpsons character with the goatee and baseball hat. That's what I tried to look like in the past. The actual motivation is being able to do enjoyable, curiosity-driven research and try to make the world a better place for all. And in the path to doing so, I guess the path is more enjoyable than the final goal. The ability to train students and transform their lives, and many of my students are in the audience today, is the greatest reward we can expect for what we're doing. And I'm totally indebted to my partners in crime, Anna Swan and Bennett Goldberg, shown in this picture. This was an engineering magazine in 2003 featuring our lab and talking about how our interdisciplinary team is collaborating across the scientific boundaries and international borders. And that's basically the theme. You can have a bit more cynical perspective. And this is a much later cartoon. This is, even the younger ones among you are probably familiar with Dilbert. And his boss is otherwise not qualified for anything. He's trying to come up with a sexy project. And he's using all the buzzwords. We'll come back to that. He wants to develop a nanotechnology, stem cell technology for fighting terrorists. Well, that's how you get money from the federal government. And that's the underlying hidden motivation. A bit more altruistic motivation. I mean, it's somewhat, against the causality. After you do the research, you go back in time and say, well, what was my motivation? I can, basically frame it. But I don't have to go too far back, because in March 2011, we took a bunch of students to Nicaragua under our efforts of exposing them to global health issues. There were 14 students from mostly undergraduates. There was, I think, one graduate student. And Kathy and that was Jake. And Kathy and Irving, along with me, were at this trip. So when we visited their neighborhoods, shanty towns, I mean, I was very happy to hold this baby and have my picture taken. I didn't know I was going to use it in a presentation in the future, but here it is. Her family had access to clean water between 10 p.m. and 2 a.m. or something like that. And they were sharing this one faucet with three families. And their house was built on top of a garbage dump. And in the city, across from the state hospital, there was this private lab. So they didn't have such a facility in the state hospital. So you could do your molecular testing if you bring your samples to this facility and pay extra money. So the idea is, can we make the best technology also the cheapest technology? That's one, very altruistic motivation that one can imagine. We're not there yet, but I'll tell you the story of how we're trying to get there. I'm an electrical engineer. All those titles Ken mentioned, and it's also on my business cards. I have no degrees in any one of those, right? I'm a professor of physics without, I did enjoy physics classes. Let me give you that. Anyway, so I learned electromagnetics and waves. That's what my comfort zone from the undergraduate years. And you know about water ripples interfering. If they end up having their crests match, they will build on one another, and it will be a stronger wave. Or if they match crest to trough, they will cancel out, and it may end up canceling completely out. So it's the constructive interference versus destructive interference. And we see this in light also. And people actually have seen this in the nature for many years, well before electromagnetic theory existed. And this is a picture of an oil slick. This is what we want to see less in the world if we can afford it. We want to see more soap bubbles and less oil slicks. And this has a film of oil on top of water, and the thickness of the film is changing a little bit across this dimension. And that's why you see beautiful colors, because some of them are destructively interfering while others are constructively interfering. So it's basically the soap bubble, right? So what is soap bubble? Soap bubble is some water trapped between two layers of soap molecules. And when you look at this region, you blow it up and see what happens when you shine light on it. Light will reflect from the top surface of the film as well as the bottom surface of the film, and those two ways will interfere when they're reflected back to the person. If they are interfering constructively, they will build. If they're interfering destructively, they will cancel out. Now, the conditions for interference is depending on the thickness of the film in relation to the wavelength of light. So for some colors, this will be constructive. Some other colors, it will be destructive interference. Just like the oil film, you will see colors on a soap bubble. And since the soap bubble thickness is varying across, some colors will be brighter at different points, and you'll end up with these beautiful patterns. So we've seen this, we've observed this, you know, all of us, all the time. But most people do not realize that by just calling out what the color is, you're doing a measurement in the order of nanometers. So nanometers are still easy to understand, comprehend, because they're large enough to sort of wrap your minds around. A large protein molecule is about 10 nanometers. So you're doing a monolayer measurement of protein molecules existing if you could put them on a soap bubble. So you could see it by your eye by saying it's a darker shade of red versus lighter shade of red, and therefore its existence of proteins. Now, interference can be extremely powerful. And the next thing I'm going to show you on the slide is something I've used on my presentations for about 8 years or so, and I've removed it from my presentations last fall. I had to put it back on. You know, they had to wait until I took it off to observe the gravity waves for the first time. Now, this is the ultimate interferometric measurement. Now, the measurement they can do across about 2.5 miles is 0.1 atometer displacement. So what is 0.1 atometer? So it's going to be very, very hard to comprehend that. If you take a hydrogen atom, that's about 0.1 nanometer. So you take a millionth of it, you go to a femtometer. If you get another thousandth of it, then you go to an atometer. So it's the size of 1 billionth of an atometer, of a hydrogen atom. Yet, using optical interference, we can measure that. So it's very powerful. I'm sure you're convinced now that it's powerful, right? If somebody is convinced to spend $1.3 billion and detect something happening 1.3 billion years ago, right? It must be something useful. Okay. So Newton rings is something you might have heard. He's not the first one to observe it, but he is the one who ended up giving his name because he explained it. So the power explanation is very important. He analyzed it, and it's called Newton's rings. And that was in the 1600s. This is the paper I reference in my articles occasionally. This is by George Airy. He published this paper for parallel plate equivalent of being able to observe Newton's rings. So at the time, mind you, there was no electromagnetic theory. It wasn't really understood. Maxwell didn't really write all those equations yet. But they were talking about let the vibration in the plane of reflection and things like this. But they were able to come up with the equations, which is not much different than the equations we use. So this is a phenomenon that has been long known. It's nothing new. Every time I thought I was doing something new, I just find out something has been done. It's exactly the same way about 40 years ago. In this case, about almost 200 years ago. So I could have used that picture. So I think this is 86 or 87, and that's when I was actually feeling more like the bunny. I was hired to do semiconductor device research. I had no idea what those meant. I mean, I became an IEEE fellow for, you know, my contributions to optoelectronic devices, but back then I had no idea. Then many people will credit their advisors. I will credit a Japanese professor who was visiting, because he made a very significant impact on my research. So that's what he said. He said, let's put a reflector at the bottom of the detector structure. And we were expecting that, okay, we'll have a double pass effect, so we will be able to see more absorption, a stronger photosensitivity. I remember taking this data in the spectroscopy room. It's a dark room, lights are turned off, and I'm watching the needle go up and down. And I was very pleased to see that, oh, there is plenty of structure. And the enhancement is not twofold, but it's more like sevenfold. So that was very interesting. And he was equally surprised, but we were easily, like Newton did, explain somebody else's data for fame and fortune. And that put me back into my comfort zone. So now I was working on waves, electromagnetics. I got my PhD on resonant cavity detectors. That got me a job at BU. Charles DeLisi was the dean when I was hired. So and then I had students at Boston University working on same concept, more advanced technologies, more advanced devices, over many, many years. So my first PhD student, Bora, worked on resonant cavity photodetectors, so did my last PhD student working on that topic was Femi. Now they're working for industry, all of them, except for one work in academia. So I'm at BU, I'm doing optoelectronic devices. I felt a little bit out of place. When you look around at BU, we have, didn't have it in 92, but we knew that Photonic Center is going to be built in 95 or 94. So it's the Photonic Center. And we have a world-class biomedical engineering department, a lot of interest in life sciences. And more recently, we have a new emerging infectious diseases laboratory. So when you have apples, we should make apple pie. So I'm in the physics department at Boston University because ECE at the time did not have any facilities, did not have a cooling tower, so Bennett needed half a laser, I need the half a laser, or we had money for half each and we needed one complete laser actually. So we started to work together and I'm very grateful to that day that we decided to work together. He taught me optics, microscopy, and for the last 23 years, we've been sharing labs and have very fruitful collaboration. And one day he says, we should get into biological imaging and sensing. Okay? You know, says that everybody is now much more interested in this. We have nano-optics tools. We know how to do microscopy. We should get into more of this sensing and imaging in biological systems. Charles Cantor comes to BU.
It's Charles Cantor. I'm sorry I can't be there in person to help you celebrate this wonderful lectureship, but I'm just remembering all the great times we had together, the wonderful papers we published together, and especially some very stimulating conversations like the time I challenged you to find a way to distinguish molecules a few nanometers above the surface of a plane from molecules lying on the plane. And as you know, that's become a very serious issue in understanding how DNA arrays work. So my best wishes on this wonderful occasion.
So it was a great opportunity for me to learn from the best. And we had many false starts. I mean, I tried to do it in different ways. We, you know, busted our brains and it wouldn't work. The idea was, if something is off the surface, few nanometers, can I distinguish from something directly on the surface? Few nanometers, it's a small distance. It's less than monolayer of silicon. But we knew in the literature, of course, these things come across after you start doing the work and they say, well, did anybody else do something similar? Indeed, they did. In 74, Drechshage demonstrated that if I have fluorescent molecules sitting at different heights determined by the number of lipid bilayers underneath. So he had a staircase of lipid bilayers and had the fluorescent molecules, fluorescent dye at the very top layer. And this was sitting on a reflecting substrate, and clearly what's happening is that the distance of the fluorescent molecules is changing as you go up the steps. So he saw that it's a different brightness. So there's a functional form of this brightness if you plot it as a function of the position of the molecules from the surface. And those intensity variations now can be mapped into axial position. A group at Berkeley called it fluorescence interference contrast microscopy. There is a very important lesson in this. You have to come up with a good acronym. Right? FLIC sounded great. And they were able to demonstrate very interesting results. You had a lipid layer, and you see intensity variations because there are antibodies trapped underneath, and they could locate where they are, and they could basically convert an intensity map to a topography of the surface without getting in with an AFM needle, atomic force microscopy needle, in a broad area. You could do this imaging very precisely. All right, well, how does it work? You have fluorescent molecules on a surface. You have an envelope of wavelengths emitted from this. And if I have, instead of a glass slide, I have something that reflects the light, that whole intensity could go down, depending on how far the reflecting surface is from the layer of fluorescent molecules, or it could go up. And as another scientist from Hertz demonstrated in the 90s by putting cells on a checkerboard pattern surface where the oxide thickness was varying tens of nanometers from one step to the other, he's able to show that the brightness changes at different steps. He knows where the steps are, he knows the step size. What he doesn't know is how far the cell is sitting from each step. And he can fit this whole thing and discover how far the cell is actually sitting from the surface. And his calculations led to about 12 nanometers plus or minus 3 nanometers. We looked at the same problem. We very quickly, it was about 10 seconds, to recognize all I have to do is push the mirror back. There's no limit on how far this mirror can be from the surface. It could be further back, and instead of seeing an intensity fluctuation of the whole thing, I will see spectral fringes within the spectrum of the fluorophore. And those fringes tell you exactly how far the molecules are with one measurement of spectroscopy. At any point, you can get a direct measurement, and that direct measurement can yield something in the order of 10th of a nanometer precision. So how does it work? I'm afraid there'll be some math. You have measured spectrum. This is actual data. We know that it contains the envelope of the fluorophores and an oscillatory component. Okay? So all you have to do is extract the oscillatory component, and how it's shifting left to right will tell you the axial position with sub-nanometer accuracy. Simple enough, we had a student working with Charlie Cantor from molecular biology, and he is the one who's interested in these DNA surfaces. You know, we figured out, okay, this is not so difficult. We challenged them to do the analysis. And it was a Russian kid.
Selim, I don't do math.
That's what he said. I mean, luckily we had a physics student, Mehmet, who could do math, and his work was much later, actually. But first of all, I did not believe Lev. I mean, you know, he can do math, right? I'm sure he had good enough high school education to do this kind of math. That's how much math I know anyway. So, I submit to you that this is math, right? And he is the first author of this paper in Journal of Applied Physics. So within months after that statement, and that's a true statement, I asked him to record that for me. He agreed and, you know, send that clip to me. And I don't want you to read this. Within months, he was actually doing this sophisticated mathematical calculations. And this is, stop, my disk is almost full. Isn't that nice? Okay, now, but we didn't want him to spend all his time on this and focus on the things he has the most expertise on. Basically, what he was able to demonstrate early on, this is basically the basis of our research for the following 10 plus years, on this silicon-silicon dioxide substrate, when you look at how white light reflects and look at the spectral signature, you can determine the amount of biological film on top and with sub-nanometer accuracy. Okay? That tells you how much material is there. Since the molecules are so much smaller than the wavelength of light, their conformation or the way they're sitting on the surface don't matter. In contrast, if you're looking at the fluorescence emission from the molecules attached to specific points on the biomolecules on the surface, their spectral signatures directly reflect how far they are from the surface. It's an ensemble measurement. We have to have thousands of molecules in the field of view to be able to gather enough photons to do the spectroscopic measurement. But nevertheless, you can have a DNA surface and you can determine the average conformation of these molecules on the surface. And that's exactly what we have done. That was the first publication we had in this concept of using interference for analysis of biological materials on the surface. It's an ensemble measurement method, but it can be useful if you have relatively uniform surfaces. One of the things that we studied later on is this polymeric surface. I cannot say this. That's why I wrote it down. We call it copoly. That's a lot better. And the company that sells it now in the United States also calls it copoly or MCP2. That's a lot easier. It's a wonderful polymer. It binds to the surface easily. It's very thin, about a nanometer on the surface. It likes water. It's hydrophilic. It swells in a solution environment. If you have any capture molecules, like antibodies, spotted or placed on this polymer surface, it elevates those and presents into the solution and makes them very accessible and functional probes. It's really fantastic for doing biosensor technology. Marcella Chiari in Milano, she developed this polymer when she saw our paper.
We could not find techniques to validate swelling of our new polymer surfaces for biosensing. Chas Cantor suggested I talk to you. Can we meet when you visit Milan?
So in summary, she said, can you measure my polymer? But she did say that to first Charlie Cantor, because Charlie was the corresponding author, and Charles Cantor called me and said, well, there's this Italian scientist, their work is really good, can you work with them and measure it? And I happened to be going to Milano the same month to give an IEEE lecture, and I met with her. She remembers me as a very old fat man from our first visit. I was a lot more slender and a few years younger than today, so I don't know. And her mind has changed about that. So, okay, we started to work, and this is an ideal system for application of our technology. My PhD student, Aicha, also visited, and they were expecting a Japanese man. So that tells you about, their perception of life in some ways. Anyway, so she did these measurements and determined that these polymers actually swell about 7.5 nanometers. I'm not saying it's 7.6 nanometers, but 7.5 nanometers when they are hydrated. And the polymer is about a nanometer thick. When it's dry, it collapses onto the surface. It likes the solution. And she had a patent on this polymer. These results helped her to put it on the market. Okay, it's an ensemble measurement. And we're looking for some applications in real biological questions. So one of the things that also was brought to us, to our attention, was by a professor in Singapore, Peter Drege, and he was studying these proteins, so-called integration host factors. It's an E. coli protein. It bends the DNA about 160 degrees. Just for your information, DNA at that length is actually like a fiber. It's a stiff rod. Bending it so tightly is not easy. But it binds in the right places, and it does actually bend it 160 degrees. And this is very important for the function, right? If you wrap it, you can fit it into a smaller area, and its functionality is enabled by this protein binding. And normally, you only study these things by forming crystals of the complex, protein-DNA complex. You form a crystal, and then you can study with X-ray diffraction, and then you will know the position of each atom effectively, and you can come up with this structure. But we needed to apply our spectral interference method. First, we needed to make it a bit more uniform so I can study this as an ensemble. So we looked to another group in Munich. They were making these switchable DNA surfaces. So basically, by applying electric field, they could lift up the DNA from the surface, order them in a more or less vertical conformation. And if then you have binding of protein and bending of the DNA, we should be able to see this difference. That's how we started to do with Phil. And we're actually successful, but there were a lot of problems with applying electric field into a physiological solution. You have bubbles forming, and that was a nightmare. And again, we went back to our polymer magician, Marcella. She made a polymer, which is pH-dependent charge polymer. So you change the pH, it becomes positively charged at low pH. You increase the pH, it becomes negatively charged. Mark Grandstaff will know about these things because, you know, he makes these polymeric nanoballs to introduce drugs into cells, and in the cell environment, pH is a little lower, they expand. This is similar principles. So she made these polymers, and we're able to put together, publish in a couple months ago, the final capability of being able to do these spectral measurements. I don't want you to look at this instrument. It's a relatively complex instrument. What it can do is, for multiple spots side by side, and these have different molecules of DNA, different sequences of DNA, and you introduce protein in a solution, and they bind to the surface, you can do real-time measurements. So you can observe what's happening on the surface in time. You can determine how much material is binding to the surface by looking at the white light spectroscopy signature. And the DNA molecules have fluorescent molecules attached to their tips or at the bottom. And by looking at the spectroscopic signatures of those fluorescent molecules, you can measure their conformation. So for the first time, we're able to do a very quantitative study. You know how many DNA molecules you have per unit area, how many of them have proteins bound to them, and their conformation, because their normal conformation is nearly vertical to the surface because of the charge repelling of the polymer. So we were able to determine when IHF binds, is it specific to the sequence? Is it functional? Because you have one SNP, it is still strongly binding to DNA, but it's not bending it. One SNP is one single nucleotide polymorphism. One sequence of DNA is replaced by another. So we can also determine, some of you cannot see this image, but depending on the binding site, we can distinguish where it's binding. So this is a known binding site, but we moved it up and down, and we have about 1 to two nucleotide precision in determining it. So we have this white light technique and the fluorescence imaging technique. All of our earlier work was ignoring all of this white light capability, and we were focusing on more challenging problems. And it turns out this is the more practical problem, practical application. It's like a soap bubble. It's light reflecting from it. It behaves like that. It looks a little dirty, and I can't really get the molecules on this, so I have to find the perfect soap bubble. An oxidized silicon is the perfect soap bubble. That's the best glass you can get. And silicon forming a native oxide is the primary reason you have computers, that being a semiconductor, other things also. And you can see in an oven, when you grow different thicknesses of silicon dioxide, they look different colors because the reflecting light is interfering constructively at a particular wavelength. This actually is from an outreach program funded by Undergraduate Engineering Division of NSF in New Mexico. And they can make so-called a rainbow silicon wafer. So you etch it at different depths, and you can see the rainbow colors reflected strongly at different positions. So doing a wavelength measurement is hard. But instead, you can change the wavelength of light and do an intensity measurement using a camera at millions of pixels. You can buy a 10 megapixel camera today, and every phone has a 10 megapixel camera. So I can do this intensity measurement. As I change the wavelength of light, for each pixel, the strength of the light reflecting from the surface will change as I sweep the wavelengths. And it will have a specific functional form. If there is anything on the surface in addition to the plane surface, that signature will shift, and so-called phase shift between the two will tell you how thick the additional material is. Using that, we can do a picometer measurement very easily. Using four LEDs, turning them on one at a time, we can extract this information and do a 1 picometer measurement, which corresponds to approximately 1 picogram per millimeter square of protein or DNA. So it's a powerful technique. We recognize this, except there was no money, right? Yeah. That helps, right? And that's me sitting in the lab after it's being renovated. It's completely empty. This is on the 7th floor. Two things happened. One, I mean, after we showed some success, not immediately at the beginning, Photonic Center gave us new space, and that was Professor Ruane's laboratory. He cannot be here, unfortunately. Mike was so generous, he let me into his lab, and Helen helped to renovate this lab, and we had a beautiful space on the 7th floor of the Photonic Center. That's one of the best places to work in the whole world. Not our lab, just the Photonic Center as a whole. Anyway. And more importantly,
I want to work on biosensors, and I'll work as a teaching fellow if necessary.
David said, I mean, we tried to recruit him for another project in the past, and he said no, and he was a teaching fellow. He was working in Mike's high technology tools or something like that, tools and toys lab under the NSF research center. And he said, I want to work on a project to do biosensors. And we had the wrong ideas, we worked on wrong things, but slowly we started to develop the understanding and we demonstrated useful things. And he wrote proposals, right? You know, Charles and I helped him also. So we got some funding and we were able to demonstrate the first demonstration of our now called IRIS, interferometric reflectance imaging sensor. The story behind this and the acronyms is, it used to be called spectral reflectance imaging biosensor, and that's the name I came up with. CIRID, as the Italians called it. And they told me, like, we can't keep talking about CIRID. It's just so hard to say. You have to come up with a new acronym. And I had a challenge of my students saying that, okay, well, come up with a new acronym. And Phil was the one who came up with IRIS. He won the medal I don't know, if I bought him a cup of coffee, probably not. But since then, we've been calling it IRIS. And now, retroactively, I'm putting words into David's mouth. He's also calling it IRIS. So we did demonstrate this technology. It worked. We were able to do a very high throughput array, 1,000 spots. Everything works. And with some faculty technology development award through the Photonics Center, we actually attempted commercialization. We started a company. I don't want to delve into the details of it, but that company no longer exists. And David is here, so you can ask him why. Charles and I were founders also, so. But I'm going to just defer every question about failure of the company to the former CEO. We were just on the board. Anyway, so with this technology, we're able to do dynamic measurements and quantitative measurements. So we could see on many spots on a protein chip how other proteins are binding, and we could measure the quantity. It was quantifiable. We knew how many molecules are binding, not precisely, but you know, plus or minus 5%. Then we're looking for actually biologically relevant applications. And I was talking to Charles on a daily basis. One day I went to his office, knocked on the door. Back then I had a much higher pitched voice.
Who is it?
Ben Selim duyuyorum.
Come in, Selim. Hi. You know, I just wanted to follow up on our recent paper in biosensors and bioelectronics. It seems to me that your IRIS technology can enable important progress in addressing one of the major problems in genomics, developing a predictive understanding of transcriptional regulation. As I'm sure you know, cells in different tissue behave differently, not because of differences in genes, but because of differences in their regulatory regions and in the sequence-specific binding of protein regulators. I was wondering if you've given any thought to using IRIS to identify regions that are recognized by specific regulators. This would be an important step in understanding how different conditions result in different responses, and to some extent even why different individuals respond differently to the same conditions. Do you think that the throughput and sensitivity of IRIS is sufficient to stimulate a major advance in this area?
So, do you think I had an option to say no? The guy was the father of the Human Genome Project, and he was the dean who hired me. So I had to come up with a way of solving these problems. But I understood that there are these molecules called, proteins called transcription factors, and they have a very important role. You may have the genes in the sequence of DNA you have, but if you do not have the right promoters to attract these transcription factors, genes will not be transcribed, so they will not perform their function. So it is important to understand how strongly they bind, what they bind to, so on and so forth. That's the first step of transcription, recruiting of transcription factors to DNA. This was a heck of a tough experimental measurement because we had to read maritime journals to find out that actually many of the DNA solutions etch glass. So, I mean, salt water attacks glass surfaces. And you have to do very quantified measurements. And you have to compare single-stranded DNA on the surface binding to a molecule versus double-stranded DNA. And they have very different conformations. They don't necessarily sit similarly on the surface. So again, the polymer surface came to our rescue that allowed us to have solution-like behavior of binding of proteins to DNA. And we're able to figure out a way of making double-stranded versus single-stranded DNA have similar affinities to binding because we were able to spot them as double-strand. So they were all at the high levels of the polymer. And then we denature them so to make them the single-stranded probes on the surface. Overall, we were able to demonstrate some interesting findings. And mind you, it took us 2.5-3 years to publish this data because it was very hard to convince the scientific community. I mean, a place like Biophysical Journal, they're very traditional. We ended up doing gel experiments to prove that our results are not an artifact of our measurement system. And you can see here in this chart that knowing quantifiably how much probes you have on the surface is very important. The white bars are the probe densities measured prior to the binding experiment, and the shaded areas are the post-bind measurements. When you correct for quantity, you get a normalized measurement. This is now in units of number of molecules per unit area. And these are different sequences. This is the consensus sequence, double-stranded. This is what TATA binding protein, TBP, is expected to bind to. And this is the single-stranded version of it. And this is the repeated sequence of T's only. And this was actually put on the chip initially as the control sequence. So we knew that, oh, it won't bind here, so we will be able to figure out. But and then we were very surprised. We repeated the experiment a dozen times, and we were convinced. And more importantly, it not only binds very strongly to polity, but also if you increase the number of sequences of polity, it binds even more. It binds as many as 5 or 6 molecules per that DNA segment. So the final conclusions we have is it was binding to TATA motif as well as the polity sequences, and it can bind multiple, it can recruit many more TBP molecules from the solution. But if it's irrelevant, it doesn't matter. But it looks like 1/3 of human promoters have a polity stretch near them. It can be over here, over here, over here, but near the promoter sequence, there is a polity sequence. So this would recruit the TBP molecules, either compete that away from this or recruit them so they can have access to it. So it's not understood how it works, but basically there is a question if these triple repeated sequences play an important role in biological processes. That question remains unanswered because we came very close with Keck Foundation, went all the way to site visit, but we didn't get funding for it. And it was a little too far out for NIH to fund us. So, but we did some preliminary studies, and we demonstrate that this same protein binds to other triple repeats, and the estrogen receptor also binds to a triple repeat sequence. And we've done these things early on. And that led me to have another collaboration. This doesn't show up, but I'm going to tell you what was on this. With Caroline Janko, we used the same technology to actually discover new sequences that recruits fur protein, the ferric optic protein that has a role in gonorrhea. So I worked on STDs also. recently, and it's an ongoing project, we're applying some of this findings to calibrating and quality controlling microarray chips made by industry. And we have an ongoing project with Cyneon where we build an instrument, a prototype instrument, and we can characterize thousands of spots potentially very quickly on a microarray chip. Now, something completely different. Finally, we're getting into single particles. I will try to show you that we can detect individual particles. If they are large enough nanoparticles, such as viruses, then we can see them directly. If they are proteins or DNA molecules, then we have to label them with a small metallic nanoparticle, then we can see them. If we can see them individually, that means we have single molecule sensitivity. That is the ultimate detection capability you can achieve. The competing technologies for detection, the most common one is known as ELISA. You have capture probes on the surface. You capture the target protein. You cannot see its presence directly. And you decorate it with a secondary antibody, which has an enzyme or fluorescent molecule that makes it visible. That allows you for the transduction. Label-free detection has been the holy grail of biosensing, and surface plasma and resonance is a very successful technology. Biocore developed this technology and sold their company to GE Healthcare for almost $400 million. But that has not really found application in healthcare yet. It's a research lab tool. This does do label-free measurements and is comparable to the technology I described to you with the soap bubble. For infectious diseases, when you're trying to detect the presence of a pathogen, the easiest thing, or maybe the most distinguishing thing to look at is its genome. And you can amplify it by using polymerase chain reaction, and then you have sufficient signal. This works very well, and it's the gold standard of the technology for detection. Except it's big, it requires a lab, and it's desirable to have compact things to do same functionality. Single particle detection has been the physicist's dream of solving these problems. They're too small, you cannot see them. All right, so what do? I enhance the optical signal by putting a resonator, or I reduce the interaction volume to tiny little bit and there is no more than one molecule in it, and I can use some high sensitivity or application amplification techniques to see presence of that molecule. Things like digital PCR or single molecule assay technology, one of David Wolf's companies, are based on reduced volume. So why is digital important? First of all, doing an analog measurement is hard. What you're doing is you're trying to measure the precise darkness of this color effectively, right? You do an ELISA, you're trying to measure colorimetrically how dark is this green. And that's not that precise. When you do a digital measurement, you're deciding if there is a one or zero. So you're comparing absence to presence, and you can have a much higher fidelity measurement more easily. So I liken the analog measurements to the vinyl recording. Again, those of you alive in the 70s would remember that we had music recorded on these giant, you know, vinyl things, and then you put on a turntable. The stylus follows the grooves and transduces the height of the groove to an electrical signal, which is then amplified to generate the sound. I can see some difficulties with that. First of all, you need the best technology to transduce. The better your record player, the higher quality of sound you get. Can you take it into a car? If you are beating up on everybody, you're the world champion boxer, yes, you can. You have enough money to buy the most sophisticated vibration-isolated vinyl player for your car. But many of you probably have not seen a record player in a car. I have seen once. Instead, you can run with it if it's a digital recorded technology because transduction is so much simpler. So David Walt, whom I borrowed this figure from, started Illumina and also started Quanterix, and they build an instrument. I liken that to the first CD player, which is, at the time, in 1983, a $900 player, and which transformed later onto a CD Walkman and other things. So the technology has potential promise, but it requires that you see small things. Optical microscopy can see small things. 400 years ago, when they invented the first microscope, they were able to see small things, bacteria. All right? They were easily. I mean, today we can see bacteria again under an optical microscope. But we cannot see viruses because bacteria is larger than wavelength of light. So in a contrast microscopy, it is easy to see it if you have sufficient magnification. Viruses are much smaller. This is a borrowed from a Raman work from Larry Ziegler. This is a bacterium, and those are nanoparticles that are put in there to enhance the Raman spectra of this bacterium. And you can see how small those 80 nanometer gold nanoparticles are compared to that. So the main technology to image viruses has been electron microscopy. You can get, you know, a few nanometer resolution, and you can see these viruses very clearly. And that's how they diagnose Ebola as a different disease. They said, oh, this looks like a shepherd's crook. This is nothing like we've seen before, so it must be a new disease. So why is that, that we cannot see it? If a particle is much smaller than the wavelength of light, its contrast is proportional to scattered light. And that scales with its volume. You do an intensity measurement, you take a square of that. So therefore, your signal depends on the sixth power of the size. Let me put it in different words for you. If the size drops by a factor of 10, contrast drops by a factor of a million. So it disappears into the crowd. So you can no longer see it. Here comes the soap bubble. All of a sudden, you have a cross term, interference term, which scales by the volume, not the square. So if it drops by a factor of 10 in size, the contrast drops only by a factor of 1,000, or it's effectively 1,000 times brighter than it would have been otherwise. So we had this idea that we can probably see these things. But everybody was busy working on their projects with the old technology in our lab. So I went back to my recruiting pool, electronics class. Back then, biomeds were required to take it. So I enjoy teaching electronics very much. This must be the first year I'm working as an associate dean. And I ran into two bright-eyed kids in the class, George and Rahul, and I tried to challenge them to do this project with me. Can you do your senior project with me? I have this brilliant idea. I think it's going to work. Nobody else believes that it's going to work, but you should try it. And
ooh, this sounds like a cool project, but we don't know any optics. Are you sure we can do this?
So I had the answer for that. I gave them a book. And that's our former chairman's book, Bahasale's book on fundamentals of photonics. That was sometime in August. I gave them the book. I said, you have a month before September. Learn some optics. Read the first five chapters. They did. And they took on this challenge. And this is the back of the envelope idea I had. So I have a 100 nanometer particle. If I were to squish it down, it would be about a nanometer size film on the surface. If I can get 1 micron resolution on optical system, I should be able to see these things. And this is the set of data they first got. And I cannot believe BME gave them the best senior design award with this data. Yes, that's some tape junk on the surface. There are two images here. Oh, okay, there's about a 1.5 nanometer signal. Only a few months later, over the summer, they got a little better image. Again, these are polystyrene beads, 100 nanometer in size. They had fluorescent molecules embedded in them, so you could see them under a fluorescent microscope. And we can see them without turning on the fluorescence laser under our setup. I mean, these are very clear. I ran the emboss function of Photoshop to amplify the signal, but that's pretty good. I mean, these are the nanoparticles, and we had one-to-one verification. Overall, the system works like this. You have a soap bubble. You functionalize with different capture molecules. You incubate with the target sample. You capture them. Now we can measure the size of individual particles that we are detecting. So we can discriminate against things which are not like the ones that we are trying to detect. Size and shape sorting eliminates false positives. And we can multiplex tens of different molecules for capture. And you see images like this. You can sort it out on a very simple optical system with a 50x objective and an LED illuminator and a camera. That's it. Going back to my first motivation, I needed to fight the terrorists. To do that, you need to study things that are lethal, right? So you can't really work with them in our lab. And luckily, Boston University was building this BSL-4, biosafety level 4 facility, and recruited a bunch of scientists to work with that. And we had an opportunity to respond to a call from NIH on biodefense, and we proposed to study these deadly pathogens, Ebola, Marburg, and Lassa fever, using a pseudotype replica. So VSV is a pathogen, not infectious to humans. It can be genetically modified to express the proteins for Ebola or other hemorrhagic fevers. So if you can capture and detect it, you can detect the bad guys. So we started to work with John Connor, and this is one of the most fruitful collaborations I had in many years. And we couldn't get into needle, but we got John Connor into our lab. Needle is not yet open for BSL-4. So we worked with the University of Texas in Galveston. So the basic idea is you have a tiled surface of antibodies on the chip. You characterize how the sizing function works. You incubate and you filter out the size. Or you have a pre-image, post-image. There are lots of things which are in the wrong size. We're using serum or whole blood. It's like the gutter. You have lots of molecules that will non-specifically bind to the surface, but you can distinguish them because they don't have the same characteristics of the virus. Antibody selectivity is important, but rejection of noise is also equally important, and we're able to go down to clinically relevant sensitivities. And we could also distinguish different pathogens from one another. These are so-called defective interfering particles, or half-size VSV, mixed in the solution, and we can see them separately, or different modifications of VSV to represent different types of pathogens. Ebola in Zaire, Sudan, versus Marburg in Zaire. So you can distinguish them based on their size. We did get a lot of publicity because of the Ebola outbreak, but that didn't really give us more money. There was lots of conversations with journalists, newspapers, the radios, but at the end of the day, US doesn't see Ebola epidemic as a threat to the United States. Okay, we can't work with the hot virus in our lab. We work with scientists at UTMB in Galveston, and they incubated our chips with Ebola samples from cell cultures, and they were able to send them back to us after they put these chips into formaldehyde solution for 48 hours. I think all the Ebola was dead after the first 2 seconds, but just to make sure, they kept it in there for 2 days. And we were also pleased to see that in our optical imaging system, since we restored the visibility of these particles, we could see the shapes without doing much. And we're able to see, for example, a shepherd's crook verified by SEM differently than a randomly coiled Ebola. And their infectivity matters. The problem with this technology so far is that we had to do this measurement in air. So you have an Ebola suspected sample. You incubate with your chip. You wash it. You dry it. Of course, you're wearing a spacesuit all this time. And then you stick it under the instrument and measure it. John always wanted to do these measurements in liquid. And I'm like, well, it won't really work because the contrast in water is going to be less. In fact, it is less because water has large dielectric contrast. Viruses are not much different than the water. They're much different than air, but their refractive indices are in the order of 1.45 or so compared to 1.33 of water. But nevertheless, through lots of engineering, we're able to demonstrate that we can detect these viruses in liquid. So we don't have to expose the samples or the chips to air. So we built some rudimentary flow cells. Here it shows the chip embedded here, and the liquid goes from one end to the other. And that's an antibody spot image through, and we can image as many as 6 antibody spots simultaneously. I'm going to blow up one of them to demonstrate to you that as the viruses get captured, we see them individually. All right, one at a time, ding, 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 and this is the edge of the antibody spot. They don't bind here, they bind over here, and I can count them. This is the best you can do in terms of detecting the presence of viruses. You see every one that you're capturing. So we benefit from having the sample with intact virus, and we're looking at the viruses directly. So you can count them. You can have a bit more of an automated system. Okay, they're coming in. So you understand that there are lots of them flowing through, but I don't see them. There are lots of other things that are flowing through. The ones that are captured only on the surface are becoming visible. Otherwise, they're too small to be seen. And with that, we're able to go down to about 100 times better than the sensitivity limit we need to be effective in this detection. And I just got the news that Steve won another award for his work. That is now too many. We'll have to share. And we were able to do multiplex measurements. You know, we put different capture probes on the surface. We can detect a different type of diseases, Ebola, Marburg, or Lassa, simultaneously on a single chip. And we can do this on a disposable cartridge. That's what we are trying to accomplish. Preliminary results show very good indication that it can actually work, and it's repeatable. This costs about $100 now, but it should cost $1 or $2 at the end of the day. So you put in the sample here, and you don't do anything else. And it's quite repeatable. And actually, we could put blood from your finger prick, because you can put a filter here and separate out the red blood cells. So you don't have to do anything, no sample prep. You put in the sample here, you push it down, it wets the channel, and there's an absorbing pad at the end. Once it goes through, you remove the sealant on top of the cap, and now air is allowed to go in, and the suction provided by the absorbing pad pulls the solution through. Chip never dries. Chip is never exposed to anything. After 20 minutes, you can stick it under the reader and count the molecules, count the viruses. So this should be very good, and we are very hopeful that it will find applications in the real world. And I'll tell you about our commercialization efforts. Proteins are too small. We can't see them directly. We decorate them with gold nanoparticles. The key here is that the gold nanoparticles we use to decorate them are not much bigger than the proteins. They can be as small as 20 nanometers, whereas the hydrodynamic radius of the proteins are maybe half that or something like this. So we decorate them and we count them. That allows us to have very, very good sensitivity. I just showed one result here. We can go down to tens of attomolar sensitivity for protein detection in serum, or for DNA, we've shown as good as 1 attomolar concentration. That's hundreds of molecules in a milliliter of solution. Typical numbers for infectious diseases is 1,000 times more or 10,000 times more than that. If you use a simple disposable test, your sensitivity is at least 1,000 times worse. So we started out on an optical bench, big instruments. When David started his company, he had a prototype system about this big. We can reduce the size further. You know, we're able to show that it can be no bigger than a pen. And I was always blessed with students very good in system development, and a variety of different contributions got into this technology. And a couple of the group members commercialized the technology. They are now incubated on the 6th floor of the Photonic Center. David and George started what was called Next Gen Arrays. Now it's called NanoView Diagnostics. And this is their instrument. It looks a lot more pleasant instead of, you know, wires coming out of it. It's well engineered, I must say. And apologies to David Bergstein, I put this slide up with this cartoon, which I modified clearly. It wasn't about Iris in the original form. It was talking about the wheel. And I think with the Zore, we were somewhere in between the triangular and square wheel. It wouldn't roll very well. You have to really push it hard. But I think with next gen, we are somewhere here. And we're not too far from a very well-functioning instrument. In the lab, our instruments look more like this. There's no reason to package them, except for industrial collaboration work. And I have a whole bunch of students working on advancing this technology further. We're trying to understand the theoretical basis and using that understanding to enhance the methodology. We can do better. We're doing the passive cartridge development. We're applying it to a variety of different applications in real-time detection of DNA, single nucleotide polymorphism or rare mutations. And most recently, we are starting a project characterizing oncolytic viruses. These are now FDA-approved treatment for cancer. They desperately need a quality control tool because when you make the viruses, you end up with a whole bunch of non-functioning viruses, and you need to know how the quality of your drug is when you're making it. So in conclusions, this is the part you're all waiting for. Optical interference is a very powerful sensing technique. If you have $1 billion, I'll build you a LIGO. Multidisciplinary innovation is the really driving force of discovering new things and making the lives of everyone better. I mean, we worked on single virus detection. We can do digital protein and nucleic acid detection and counting, and this can be done in a very simple instrument. For the demonstration of an engineering research center presentation, we actually did this on a cell phone. There's really no reason to do it on a cell phone, but people wanted to see it that way. And our Dean Fougere actually uses our technology in outreach, so the kids can do interferometric measurements and measure things which they cannot fathom about, you know, how small they are. The lesson I learned, among other things, I shouldn't ask anyone named Charles for a sentence to include in my presentation. Okay. So I have so many people to thank. I'm going to miss, you know, 9/10 of those. First of all, I'm very thankful to Boston University for providing an incredibly rich environment for research. I've been here 24 years, very happy. The environment is wonderful. And it does actually have no barriers between different disciplines. You know, this is a picture from 2012 when our group was much larger. And that's misspelled physics. And we had all these soap bubbles. And you know, so customary to thank all the funding agencies. We had a whole bunch of them. And I mentioned lots of people in my presentation. A few people I didn't mention from the medical school are listed here. And I'm grateful to Photonic Center being such a wonderful environment, and it's really well run. And future is bright. I think we're going to do better in the future. We've got to wear shades. And I'm training the next generation. I bought him his first microscope. He was not very interested in it. It's 1x microscope. You can see things better if you have them outside the microscope. I want to finish thanking love of my life, my wife. And without her, we could not have a picture like this taken. People were very stiff. We're all, you know, mostly engineers, you know, stand like this when you're pictures taking. And she's been a big sister to many of my students, and she's actually enhanced our lives in many ways. And today, it happens to be her birthday. So, so, questions?
We do have a reception for Selim right after this in the lounge upstairs. We have time for one or two questions. If anybody has something they want to ask. These guys are ready with microphones. Okay, so we do have some gifts for Selim.
Uh-oh.
I think. I hope. Otherwise, I'm going to be an idiot.
You can give me your wallet.
Yeah, exactly. Okay, first, a framed photograph of myself. No, just
that other guy who was in the pictures.
Second, while I would have loved to continue to raise money for yet another endowed chair professor, this is an endowed physical chair that says Selim Ünlü, College of Engineering, 2016 Distinguished Lecturer.
Thank you very much.